Tulsi Gabbard made an appearance on Tucker Carlson's show Monday, where she talked about Islamists being the biggest threat facing the nation today. Here's the clip.
We thought it'd be interesting to see what Tulsi Gabbard thinks about this. She's a former member of Congress from Hawaii. She served in Iraq as a member of the Hawaii Army National Guard. She's still serving the country in the military. She joins us tonight. Congresswoman, thanks so much for coming on. So you get to lie. I mean, this will not shock you because you've seen it so much, but you get to lie about the loss of human life. You get caught and nothing happens to you. What kind of system is that?
I mean, this kind of accountability is critical. I want to point out first that anytime there are civilian casualties in war, it is tragic and terrible. Yeah. War is a terrible thing. And I think it's important for the American people to understand that Islamist jihadists are continuing to wage war against us. And the Islamist ideology, not the same as the religion of Islam, but this Islamist ideology, which is a political ideology that inspired the terrorist attacks on our country on 9/11, is the greatest threat that we're facing right now in this country and the world. It is the foundation of governance of so-called Islamic countries like Turkey and Iran and Saudi Arabia and Pakistan. And it's what's behind the discriminatory policies that they have in these countries against Christians, Hindus, Buddhists, atheists, and others. So as long as these Islamist jihadists are waging war against us, we have to work to defeat them militarily and ideologically. And militarily, we have two choices in how we do that. Number one, we can continue to invade and occupy and nation build in countries around the world, just as we did in Afghanistan at great cost. Number two, we can take a targeted approach using airstrikes, using our special forces to go in and go after these terrorist cells. The reality is that the cost to the American people, the cost to our troops, the cost to civilians will be far less if we take this very targeted approach to go after these jihadist terrorist cells than if we continue making the very same mistakes that we saw in Afghanistan and other parts of the world of invasion, occupation, and nation building.
So in order to do that or to affect any successful military strategy, you have to have competent people running things. And doesn't competence require honesty and accountability? And that's what I see missing here. It's like you're not allowed to lie to the public, which employs you, are you?
The American people deserve honesty. They deserve leaders who lead with integrity and not those who shy away from their own responsibilities to the American people or look for a lower ranking fall guy to take the hit. The American people deserve strong leadership that looks out for their best interests and the best interests of our country.
Now, this comes just days after revealing on Twitter that she had recently been deployed to Africa as support for special forces fighting Al-Qaeda. This is what she had to say.
Aloha, everyone. You haven't heard much from me lately. I've been gone for the last 4 months, serving on an active duty tour and deployment to Africa as a civil affairs officer. I was supporting a special forces mission to go after Al-Qaeda-affiliated jihadists. Now, every single day, it was truly my honor to work with incredible patriots, experienced, focused warriors with an unwavering commitment to serve our country. We should never forget that, you know, no matter the decisions that the politicians make or the careerists in the Pentagon make, it is our men and women in uniform who selflessly and quietly defend the safety, security, and freedom of our country every day. Now, I haven't posted much since I was gone because I was asked not to talk about my going overseas until my mission was complete. Al-Qaeda is very active where we were, and as someone who has a high profile, I would have been a prime target for the enemy, putting my life and the lives of my fellow service members and our mission in greater danger. Now I look forward to discussing the foreign and domestic issues and challenges that we're facing in our country.
Also on September 11th, Tulsi posted to Twitter, quote, "Let us never forget that it was the Islamist ideology which inspired the terrorist attacks and declaration of war against America on 9/11, and it is this Islamist ideology that continues to fuel terrorist attacks around the world and is the foundation for so-called Islamic countries like Pakistan, Turkey, Iran, and Saudi Arabia's discriminatory policies against Christians, Hindus, Buddhists, atheists, etc." All right, so let's go ahead and unpack all of this. First of all, I did reach out to Tulsi Gabbard. I invited her to be on this show to discuss her her involvement in these over-the-horizon targeted attacks against Islamists, in her assertion that Islamist ideology is the greatest threat facing America today. I have reached out to her. I did not hear back, but the invitation still stands. So if she would like to come on this show or at least issue a statement, she is absolutely more than welcome to. Now, I also want to point you to a radar that I did recently on Hills Rising. As you know, I've been co-hosting the show for the last 7 weeks. I did take this week off from the show. But I did do a radar that I think you should watch, talking about how the war is not really over in Afghanistan, that Joe Biden is shifting his focus to targeted attacks, what they're called over-the-horizon targeted attacks, and I detail exactly how this new form of warfare came about. But I will, of course, go through some of that here with you now, but I do have more sources and details in that radar that you could check, and that is on a playlist on my channel down below. So, listen, intervention warfare, as far as boots on the ground, swarming a country with an invasion, that is old form of warfare that really no one is discussing doing anymore, be they Republican or be they Democrat. They might posture a little bit. You know, you might get Marco Rubio here and there saying, oh, yeah, we're going to invade Venezuela, we're going to invade Iran. But for the most part, no one actually in the Department of Defense and no one really in the military-industrial complex is thinking that that's the future of warfare for America. Everyone has shifted towards this new idea of over-the-horizon targeted attacks. And what makes these particularly very scary is they don't actually require a declaration of war. It is just the president using the old AUMF that allows them to strike and attack and use warlike tactics against areas, nations, regions, so as long as they're able to justify it as fighting terrorism. So as long as they can link it to terrorism, they're allowed to be anywhere in the world fighting in these targeted sorts of special ops warfare, drone warfare, without the American people really being any the wiser. So we saw this happen in Somalia when we had soldiers killed, and we were like, what in the world? We didn't even know they were there. This is that sort of new form of warfare. Now, this was interestingly crafted mostly under Barack Obama, this new shift in warfare, and very specifically alongside Hillary Clinton. This is what makes this particularly really interesting, that Tulsi Gabbard is now advocating and even participating in a form of warfare that is very much the foreign policy agenda of, believe it or not, Hillary Clinton. So what happened was, when Barack Obama was president, Michelle Flournoy was Undersecretary of State. Tony Blinken, who is now our current Secretary of State, was Undersecretary of State. Michelle Flournoy is Undersecretary of Defense. Tony Blinken was Undersecretary of State. They left. They created West Exec Advisors. The whole goal of West Exec Advisors was to help big tech companies secure Department of Defense contracts. This is moving warfare away from the traditional, we need lots of tanks, we need lots of equipment for boots on the ground, more towards high-tech warfare. So this has been in the works for a while, and we even saw this happening in sort of real time in the Obama administration. He was moving away from these traditional invasions like in Iraq and in Afghanistan, and instead moving towards this these sorts of mixed, he was kind of doing this mixed version of it in regards to Syria. So it was this mixture of boots on the ground and targeted attacks, over the horizon drone warfare. But Syria was largely really sort of this testing ground for this new form of warfare that the administration was shifting towards, and that the Department of Defense, the Pentagon, was shifting towards. And they've pretty much successfully done this. I mean, they have openly stated, you can get many quotes from Michelle Flournoy, from Tony Blinken, from Joe Biden and his ilk, talking about moving towards these over-the-horizon targeted attacks. This is why I say wars are not really ending, they're just shifting. And unfortunately, they're shifting into a direction where there's really no oversight by the American people. When the American people don't know about deployments of troops, and we're not seeing large swaths of our loved ones being sent overseas to fight wars, the American people kind of forget. You know, we just kind of go back to drinking our coffee and eating our bagels, and it's no big deal. And so we don't even know or pay attention to these special ops attacks that are happening around the world, and we don't even know where they're happening. So that in and of itself is extremely scary. Secondly, Africa, you know, Al-Qaeda in Africa is not an actual threat to the United States. And in fact, I really do take issue with this idea that Islamists, there is a difference between Islam and Islamic and Islamists. So Islamist is the nuanced term for, you know, like Al-Qaeda, real radical fringe groups like Al-Qaeda and ISIS and whatnot. And I take an issue with the thinking that these Islamists are the greatest threat facing the country today. I don't believe it. I don't think there's any evidence of this. If you're just going to continue to point to September 11th, an event that happened 20 years ago, it was extremely tragic, it was extremely terrible, and you're going to continue to point at that, which our government has, our Department of Defense has, the Pentagon has, continue to point at that one event to continue to justify endless wars, endless warfare, droning of civilians, killing of children. They continue to use that as the excuse for, well, we got to fight these terrorists. We got to fight these terrorists all around the world. They're such a threat. They're in Africa. You got to go all the way to Africa to fight them. I mean, does anybody notice how this is a farce, a scam? It is just the rhetoric is to keep the military industrial complex going. It is to keep these contracts going. It is to continue to allow the president to have endless war powers that go unchecked. And furthermore, when we really look at Africa and this now new attempts to destabilize Africa, you have to ask yourself why. Why are we in Africa fighting Al-Qaeda, which I'm sure is a very unsophisticated cell of Al-Qaeda that doesn't have any real ability to threaten the United States all the way where we are here today? What is really going on there? Well, we know China's trying to build their Belt and Road, right, all the way through Africa. They've been trying to build Africa, bring Africa up into the first world. They've been investing in Africa. Now, whether you agree with that or not, that is what's been going on. Whether you think there's some sinister motive or they're putting them in debt, you know, there's a lot of different ideas regarding that. But nonetheless, Africa is getting a heavy amount of investment from China. And the United States, you know, will do anything possible in order to destabilize the region in order to halt China's growth. So now you're participating not in keeping America safe, not in really truly fighting an enemy that's an actual danger to me, my life, as I walk out the front door, but you're just helping the military-industrial complex and the globalists maintain power through destabilizing China's effort at expansion. That's all that this is. And we know that we have a history of destabilizing regions using a variety of tactics, whether it be through sanctions or regime change or through drone war, through flat-out war invasions, and through these sort of even the exportation of Wahhabi Salafist ideology, which if you ask Saudi Arabia, they say, yeah, okay, we maybe did that, but we were doing it because America asked us to do it, right? So you get all these different viewpoints and these different assertions when it comes to how in the world did this very fringe Islamist ideology, how did it, you know, enmesh its way all the way around the world from the Middle East, from Saudi Arabia into deep into Africa now, and even into Asia, well into Asia. How did that happen? And again, you know, the Saudis will say, well, because they had a lot of money and they were able to then set up mosques and send their imams all around the world. And they say, well, we were doing that, but we were doing it because the United States asked us to do it. Now, of course, that's just speculation. He said, she said sort of stuff. But nonetheless, it's interesting, intriguing, and eyebrow raising. So now, you know, Tulsi Gabbard goes to Africa to help these special ops over the horizon style attacks that were crafted by Hillary Clinton, oddly enough, and then also lumps Iran into the whole group, which, by the way, doesn't belong there at all. Iran is a totally different ideology. Now, if she wants to pick a bone with Iran, fine. do that separately. That's a separate issue. Throwing them in there is just pandering to the Israeli base, is to say, well, you know, hey, Israel, I got your back. Okay, if you want to pick a bone with Iran because you want to side with Israel, then go do that, but do that separately. They don't belong in this conversation. So that's also eyebrow raising about these statements. Also, you know, for those of us who supported Tulsi Gabbard in her presidential campaign, this is very disappointing. This messaging is very disappointing. But when I look back at her campaign, I sit there and I think, well, maybe I just wasn't really listening, right? I mean, I heard end regime change and these interventions and, you know, end this sort of wasteful war. And maybe I just thought that included these unnecessary destabilization over the horizon drone attacks. I just kind of assumed it included that. And maybe I was wrong on that. Clearly, I was wrong on that. I was wrong to think that it included that when now she's clearly coming out saying, no, I'm for these targeted attacks. In fact, I participate in these targeted attacks, just went to Africa for 4 months to help with it. So I'm not only okay with it, I'm for it, I'm participating in it. And I guess as myself, as someone who was very supportive of the campaign, I perhaps didn't hear that message. And there were very, very staunch critics of her, as many of you know who were also following Tulsi. There were some very, very staunch, loud voices that came out saying, no, she's actually all about droning. And many of us went to bat for Tulsi, and now we're eating crow. There's no other way to say it, you know? I was wrong in thinking that she wasn't for this type of warfare. Clearly she is. Maybe she always was upfront about that and I just didn't hear her, and now it's, and maybe it's my fault. And that very well could be. But I do find it odd that this is the very foreign policy, you know, warfare tactic that was developed by Hillary Clinton. And, you know, Tulsi Gabbard and Hillary Clinton had a very public display of animosity towards one another. It looked like Tulsi was very much going after Hillary and Hillary is going after Tulsi. And so it then leads me, of course, because I question everything, as so should you, it leads me to wonder if, you know, why was there this beef amongst both of them when in the end they end up in the same place, right? Which is, no, what we want is we want these new high-tech, over-the-horizon drone warfare, secret warfare, unchecked by the American people. This is the direction we want to go in. It makes me wonder if, you know, because look, if Hillary Clinton's for something and people who are against Hillary Clinton, they're going to automatically be against anything Hillary Clinton wants. But if fierce enemies of Hillary Clinton are then saying, no, this is what we want and this is good, then you kind of lose that, right? Then suddenly you're not going to get pushback to this activity. So now we have both sides advocating for this new form of warfare, which is the Hillary Clinton camp, who this was all started under, and now the anti-Hillary Clinton camp, thanks to Tulsi Gabbard, helping usher that mentality forward on Tucker Carlson's show and on her Twitter account. So that is very concerning to me and very, very disappointing. Lastly, the last point I want to make on this is, if you want to defeat Islamist ideology, if you want to stop terrorists, you don't bomb them into oblivion. You don't bomb them into the Stone Age and then expect them to act anything less than barbaric. So if you want people to progress, if you want them to stop being backwards thinking, people that are oppressive and going after Buddhists and atheists and Christians and Hindus, if you want that to end, you have to help these groups build economically to where they have prosperity, they have a future, they have something to look forward to. You don't bomb them and harass them and frighten them to where the only thing they think they can turn to is God. That has the opposite effect, as we've seen over and over and over again. So building up an area economically is the best way to move them forward and to give them, to move them in progress. When you've got a lot of jobs because you've got an economic booming society, then you don't have enough people, you don't have enough men to fill all the jobs. You need women to join the workforce too. That's how it works. That's how it's worked in Saudi Arabia. So you need economic prosperity. As economic prosperity grows more and more, bigger and bigger, suddenly you end up with more and more opportunity for people that are typically oppressed. They need the people. They need them to work. They need them to be educated. They need them to participate in society. They don't oppress them. because they're booming economically. So that is how you develop and fight these extremist ideologies. You don't bomb them into oblivion. You don't bomb them into the Stone Age. You help them, lift them up, and then eventually the people will say, hey, and we saw this in Saudi Arabia. The women have been working there for a long time because they just have too many jobs. They don't have enough men for all the jobs, so the women have to work. And then as they progressed and they continued to economically develop, they started to get technology. And as they got technology and people were happy and they weren't worried about being bombed, they weren't worried about if they were going to have food to eat, you know, they don't have to worry about these other stressors. They instead start to worry about things like, hey, we can't go to the movies. We're going online and we're seeing all these other countries going to the movies. We want to go. We want movie theaters. So they get movie theaters. The women go online and hey, other women in other countries are driving. Hey, why can't I drive? They're not worried about being bombed. They're not worried about clean water. They're not worried about eating. They're not worried about whether or not they're going to make it past 45 years old or if their men are going to come home from some war. They're not worried about that. They're worried about whether or not they could drive and go to movies. That's how you create progress in a country with an ideology that has what seems to us to be background ways of thinking. That's how you do it. It's diplomacy. It's peace. And that was the message that I thought Tulsi Gabbard had in her campaign, throughout her campaign. So it is very disappointing for me to discover that she instead is advocating for, to go and fight al-Qaeda in Africa, where, quite frankly, I don't think they actually pose a single threat to you or I here in America at all today. That is manufactured, I believe. And it's only meant to destabilize the region and keep China from developing. And she's participating in that from my point of view. Now, again, I've invited Tulsi Gabbard here to discuss this. I would love to still have that conversation. She did not get back to me, but she is free by all means to issue a statement about this or to come on the show and have a conversation about this. I was a big supporter of hers. I really was a fierce advocate of what I thought was her integrity and her honesty. And so I got some questions. I have some questions, and maybe some of you do as well. Now, if you would like to comment on this, you could by all means email me. Of course, I will read your comments below, but also you could email me, kim@kimiversen.com, share with me your thoughts. Otherwise, connect with me on my locals community. In the locals community, you can discuss issues with one another. You can also watch my live streams. I do casual live streams in locals on Mondays and Thursdays. So you could join me there. Interestingly, Tulsi Gabbard, in all transparency, is actually an investor in the locals platform. So, but you know me, right? So I'm gonna do my criticizing where I feel like I need to do my criticizing, and it doesn't matter who I might or how I might be affecting myself. I doubt that I will be, though. So, but that is just in the full disclosure of full transparency from me. So you can still, however, join my locals community. And that does help benefit me greatly and helps keep me going and helps keep the show afloat. So as much as there might seem to be some sort of conflict there, I understand. Thank you guys so much for watching. Email me, kim@kimiversen.com, and thank you for watching. If you'd like to see more of my content, especially the uncensored kind, sign up for my Locals community. Locals is where we can freely discuss topics that are often censored or limited by big tech. Not only will you get bonus segments not seen on YouTube, but you'll also gain access to my casual behind-the-scenes live streams, informative postings stacked with valuable information, and even just random fun pics and videos from my personal life. It's a way to support my show while getting more content. It's $5 a month for premium access and free for others. So go to my locals page at kimiversen.locals.com.